traveling along what used to be an Indian trail, retracing the steps of the pioneers to get to the house with the pink siding.
Well, I've no head enough, my box is clean. You know what I'm saying, you know what I mean. From now on, you best call on somebody else. And while you
When was the last time that you came up here?
That was the day we left.
Lost time is not found again.
Basement tapes were recorded in the spring to fall of 1967. The majority of the recordings were made in the basement of a house in Saugerties, New York, called Big Pink.
Still pink, hasn't faded.
No, well, it's faded out slightly, but
maybe
new millennia, they call it salmon or something now. They got a fancy name.
In most cases, when you return home, everything's smaller. You know, the river isn't as wide, and the streets aren't as long, and somebody put in sidewalks. And but I don't see things change much. The mountain is bigger than it was, definitely. What are memories made of? Richard did the cooking, I did the vacuuming, and Rick did the outside work. I had this room here.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
Garth actually had a lot of production skill and a lot of production forethought in doing these tapes. And it's because of that I'm able to retrieve a lot of that information and make the tapes sound the way they are. It's because of Garth Hudson.
Yeah. And that's the writer's room with a view. That's the center of this whole operation. Yeah.
You want to look at the basement?
Yeah, we should go.
Here we go.
This is the view.
Yes.
The room with a view.
It is indeed. Nice
news. Yeah, overlook is big. We'd be around cleaning up and doing whatever we did. And Bob would come in, and then we'd sit for a while and talk about the serious stuff. Local characters, local wise men, and pretty ladies. And the typewriter would be there, and Bob would probably tap on it for a while, and then somebody would go downstairs to check the equipment or whatever. And then finally, everybody would go down the pink stairs. Sure, it's much bigger than I thought. It's really big.
I done ground it all up into molasses.
Yeah, so where the piano is, that was my bench. There was a workbench there and had the tape machine on that, and the organ was out in front of it. And the furnace, we had to turn the furnace off to record. Now
they put carpet down on the floor or to warm it up. When I say warm it up, it's up some of the reflection, the high frequency echo.
All the rafters would help. They would stop early reflections. The cement block, I'm sure we left it like that.
And a cinder block is actually very porous. It actually absorbs sound. So the sound of the garage was actually perfect for what Garth was trying to achieve.
There were two other rooms that we recorded in this area. And right away after we set up, and even before listening back, we could tell that it just didn't have the life.
Here's a reel, a Shamrock reel from the basement tapes. Yeah, 1,800 feet, yeah. So it means it's very thin.
A lot of the tape was damaged.
There's mold, there's some water damage from over the years.
Fecal matter from the barn.
Mouse shit.
These are stored in a multiple of places. I can't name all the places.
So therefore the fidelity was challenged. It would not play properly. I'd have to iron the tape sometimes and actually pull the tape slowly underneath a warm iron.
Every tape has a different story to it. Every tape has its own intrigue.
I remember when Bob recorded the Sign on the Cross. For some reason, I remember him being in the corner here, and then Robbie on this side and Rick over there, and the drums, and Richard on piano, and I would be here to push the button. Bob didn't like to sing the same song over and over again. Sounds to me like he did make up songs on the spot where he had not typed them out. I think Sign on the Cross was done in real time, both the composition and the execution thereof.